Okay, well, good morning again. Our study today is entitled, Are the Feasts an Option? But before we talk about the feast today, I want to talk to you about the Mini Cooper. Have you ever seen a Mini Cooper? They're a cute little car. The base 2014 Mini Cooper hardtop, which rides on a new front-wheel drive modular platform from BMW, comes standard with a new three-cylinder 1.5-liter turbocharged engine that makes 134 horsepower and 156 pounds of foot torque. It has a six-speed manual transmission standard, but for an additional $1,250, you can get a six-speed automatic. The typical Mini assortments of bright exterior colors and flashy trim is available, as are a few option packages that can drive up the price quite quickly. For instance, you can get the $1,750 premium bundle together. It has a panoramic sunroof, automatic cruise control, a premium sound system, rain-sensitive windshield wipers, and so on. You can get a $1,700 package, which helps you to have navigation, traffic information, sound information. There's a $4,750 fully loaded bundle, which doesn't even include the $600 cold weather package of heated seats that I know someone would like. There's a $1,500 sports package with added flasher wheels, sports seats, LED headlights, and so on. You say, what in the world am I telling you all this about? Well, I haven't even told you about the Cooper S yet, which has a standard 2-liter turbocharged engine with 189 horsepower and 207 foot-pounds of torque. Like the base model, it comes with a standard 6-speed transmission and optional 6-speed automatic. There's all kinds of colors of paints and trim, and there's probably more options available for the Mini Cooper than any other car around. I saw one time I was asking a guy about it. He said, well, you order these cars and you just go through a whole big checklist and you get a car exactly like you want. Well, a lot of things in life are options. I'm not selling Mini Coopers today, by the way. I don't have one. I'm not advocating you should buy one, at least on the Sabbath. But the fact is that many things have options, right? We buy cars. We buy different kinds of cars. We may eat different kinds of food. You may like a black suit or a blue suit. Maybe you like a blue shirt. Maybe some of you like a red shirt or a white shirt. We have options about many things. Some people live in a Christian world in which we believe that there are options. Options in the way that we can worship or not worship. Options in the way that we believe or don't believe. Now, friends, there are certain core fundamental principles and practices, fundamental principles of our belief. And I want to state today that these are not optional. They're not optional. Now, I'm speaking partly, and I say partly, in response to a message that was recently given at a camp meeting by a very good brother of mine that I love very much. And I'm going to be taking another option. In this particular message, this brother was talking about different options. And the proposition basically was that you can have an option whether to keep the feast or not to keep the feast. You can have an option whether to make a notoriety of the times that these feasts occur, or you can have the option not to do it. Just like in the early church, it seemed to be an option whether you could be involved with circumcision or not circumcision. But I'm going to come to another option about all these options in just a little bit. Now, a couple weeks ago at our prayer meeting, we began the kernel of this study, and I believe that I probably need to go back and review through some of that for those of you who have memories like I do that don't always remember everything, as well as for those who didn't get everything. But I want to begin by asking a very simple question, and that is, how many commandments are in the Ten Commandments or in the Decalogue? You might think that's such a strange question. Why would I ask how many commandments are in the Decalogue or in the Ten Commandments? Some might say, in fact, that there are 100. Or they might say that there are hundreds more that are linked to the Mosaic Law. But what does the Bible say about these matters? What do we know about the Ten Commandment Law? What do we know about these other statutes and laws and judgments? And how do we relate these two together? And I believe that inspiration has an exact answer, that we don't need to be in confusion. In Deuteronomy chapter 4, if we could begin by going to Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. And he declared unto you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, even 10 commandments, and he wrote them upon 2 tables of stone. And the Lord commanded me at that time to teach you statutes and judgments, that you might do them in the land, whether ye go over to possess it. Now notice here that there are two things. In verse 13, there are the Ten Commandments. These were written with the finger of God. But in verse 14, there were certain statutes and judgments that God gave to Moses, and then Moses gave these to the people. Now turn with me to 2 Kings chapter 21, and we'll be reading verse 8. It says, "Neither will I make the feet of Israel move any more out of the land which I gave their fathers, only if they will observe to do according to all that I have commanded them, and according to all the law that my servant Moses commanded them." Do we see here two distinct categories at this point? The law which God gave, that same law that the Bible says was written with his finger, and then the law that Moses gave, another law, a law that was an oral law. Now in Daniel chapter 9, it tells us something about this law of Moses. Daniel chapter 9, Daniel's praying. And in verse 11, Daniel chapter 9, verse 11, as Daniel's praying, he says, "Yea, all Israel have transgressed thy law, even by departing, that they might not obey thy voice. Therefore, the curse is poured upon us, and the oath that is written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, because we have sinned against him." Now notice it speaks here about a law, it's called the law of Moses, and has something to do with a curse that's poured out upon them because they had been disobedient to it. Now, the Bible says, as we noted in Deuteronomy 6, verse 14, and also in Exodus chapter 31, 18, the Ten Commandments were written with the finger of God. And they were placed in a very important and sacred place. You remember where they were put? They were put in the Ark of God. And if we turn to Exodus chapter 25, so turn with me to Exodus chapter 25, and let's read this, because we want to have a biblical basis for what we're saying. Exodus chapter 25 and verse 16. "And thou shalt put into the ark the testimony which I shall give thee." And that testimony, of course, was the Ten Commandments. And the sacred Ten Commandments were placed in the ark. But the ark also was a repository for something else. If we would turn to Deuteronomy 31, I'm going to read verses 9 and 24 through 26. "And Moses wrote this law and delivered it unto the priests, the sons of Levi, which bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord, and unto all the elders of Israel." Now verse 24. "And it came to pass, when Moses had made an end of writing the words of this law in a book until they were finished, that Moses commanded the Levites, which bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord, saying, Take this book of the law and put it in the side of the ark of the covenant of the Lord your God, that it may be there for a witness against thee." Now, is there a difference between putting something inside something or putting it in the side? There is, isn't there? If I put something inside something, it's right in the middle, we might say. But if I put something in the side, there must be like a some kind of a tray or a pouch or some kind of a holding device on the side, not inside, but on the side of the article. And so apparently when the ark was made, there was some way to put this in the side of the ark, this law. We know Aaron's rod that budded and the pot of manna were also put there as well. Now, these two laws have different authors. They're written on different material. One law was written with the finger of God. The other was written with the hand of Moses. One was put inside the ark. Another was put in the side of the ark. Do you see that God is trying to show that there is a distinct difference between these two laws? They're not just simply one law under a general heading. Now, it's interestingly that as we consider the text in Daniel 9, he says that there were curses that were poured out from this law. And it speaks there in what we read here in Deuteronomy 31, that this one law, this law of Moses, would act as a witness against them. as a witness against us. In this law, there are curses and there are penalties for disobedience that are totally lacking in the Ten Commandments. In fact, you go through all the Ten Commandments, you won't find one curse. Never find a curse in the Ten Commandments. You never find a penalty for the disobedience of the Ten Commandments within the Ten Commandments. And for this cause, the law of Moses was said to be against us. Notice Colossians chapter 2 and verse 14. It says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was, what? Against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Certainly, friends, something was nailed to the cross. And it was something that which was contrary to us. Now, friends, can you tell me if there's anything contrary to us in the Ten Commandments? Is there anything against us in the Ten Commandments? It was not against any of the new Christians, friends, to refrain from idolatry, from theft, from lying, from murder. Paul speaks of the Ten Commandments, and he speaks of them very positively. Never is something that which is against us. Never is something which is contrary to us. If we turn to Romans chapter 7 and verse 7, Paul says, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law. For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. Now, I ask you quickly here, what law says thou shalt not covet? Ten Commandments. Remember which one? Tenth. Okay. So he's speaking here about the Ten Commandments, right? No question about that. If we come down to verse 12, it says, wherefore the law is holy, and the commandment holy, and just, and good. And in verse 14, he says, for we know that the law is what? Spiritual. But I am carnal, sold under sin. So this law was spiritual. It was good. It was holy. And notice the language. For we know that the law was spiritual.
No.
No, it didn't say that, did it?
No.
It says, for we know that the law is spiritual. Now, what's the difference? Is, was.
One's still in force.
One is still in effect today. If I just say was, it could imply that it's not now, but it was then, but not now. But when Paul says the law is spiritual, the law is holy, the law just wasn't past tense holy, just and good. The law is holy, just and good. And he's speaking about the Ten Commandments here. Now, as an example, we could turn to Ephesians chapter 6. I want you to notice verses 1 through 3 here. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. And that's all present tense. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise that it may be well with thee and thou mayest live long on the earth. And so this is what God tells us, and this is a good thing. We see here that the effect of what Paul was saying, and he's writing here to the church at Ephesus. Now there's something that was part of this other law that was closely connected to the life of all the Jewish people, and that was something called circumcision. If we turn to Acts chapter 15, Acts chapter 15 and verse 5, we notice the connection here between circumcision and the law of Moses. It says, but there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. You know, there was a debate. There was a tremendous debate in the early church on whether the young men had to be, or the babies, circumcised, the male babies. Because this had been given as a sign to help demonstrate in a physical way that the Jews were God's people. Spiritually, it was to represent a cutting away of the flesh, a ceasing to depend upon the flesh and to depend fully upon God. But circumcision, of course, was not part of the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments say nothing about circumcision whatsoever. But notice what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 19. Paul says circumcision is everything. Does he say that? If you're not reading the text, unless you have it in your memory bank exact, how do you know? Look at the text, friends. 1 Corinthians 7:19, circumcision is nothing. And uncircumcision is nothing, but the keeping of the commandments of God. Paul's very plain here. that the Ten Commandments and circumcision are not connected. They're not connected at all. The moral law remains, but he says circumcision is gone. Now let's turn to Hebrews chapter 7. Notice some principles that Paul brings out here in Hebrews chapter 7 and 8. Hebrews chapter 7, I'm going to start reading in verse 12. Paul says, "For the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law." Now, is he talking about the Ten Commandment law? Maybe the law was changed. The Sabbath is no longer on Saturday. It's in Sunday now. No, no, he's talking about a law that deals with priesthood. Show me anywhere in the Ten Commandments where it speaks about priests or priesthood. Of course, it doesn't. He's talking about here about the law of Moses that dealt with all these regulations. And he says, "For the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law. For he of whom these things are spoken pertaineth to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar." Verse 14, "For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood. And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there arises another priest, who is made not after the law of a what? Carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life." If you're going to be a priest in Israel, you had to be a Levite. And you had to be a special Levite, not just any Levite. But now here comes someone from the tribe of Judah, and he's going to be a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. He says there had to be a change of this law. And this law involved what he calls carnal commandments. But remember, Paul says that the law is what? Is spiritual. The law is spiritual. Hebrews chapter 8, speaking of the priests, he says that they serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things. As a Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle, for see, saith he, that thou maketh all things according to the pattern shown thee in the mount. There was a pattern of things that was shown to him. And this pattern was a shadow, he says, of a reality. Now, a shadow can show you the outline. It can give you an understanding of what something looks like. You might even be able to see certain actions performed through watching the motions of a shadow. But the shadow is not the reality. The shadow is not the reality. It's like if I have a photograph of my daughter. I like to look at the picture when she's not around. It helps to remind me of her. But once she's here, I don't need the picture anymore. I have the reality. I have that which has substance. See, a shadow is no substance. You can't touch it. You can't weigh it. You can walk on it, but you can't really touch it. You can block it, but it has no substance. It has no reality. Now, we're talking here today about the difference between the Ten Commandments and the Law of Moses. And the Ten Commandments were to be eternal. They were written with the finger of God. They were put inside the sacred ark of God. The law of Moses was written by the hand of Moses. It's true, it was given by God. It's true, it was truth for that day, friends. But it was a truth that is no longer applicable in the same way that it was at one time. And I'm going to show you why. Now, I think we need to understand a principle because we want to understand how all this works and how does it transition from the time of Christ, the time of the apostles, to us today. Because we're not living in the time of Jesus Christ today. We're not living even in the time of the apostles. We are removed almost 2,000 years since that time. And the question is there any difference in the way that we relate to things today than the way that they related to things at that time? And I'd like to propose to you that there is indeed a difference. And part of the difference, or part of the reason for the difference, is the fact, and please listen to this carefully, truth is progressive. Now, I know you've heard that said a lot of times about this issue of the Trinity doctrine, for instance. Well, we've accepted the Trinity today because truth is progressive, and we've learned more about that. Well, the fact is, God raised up this Advent movement on a platform of truth. And that original platform of truth, friends, there were certain things that it did not contain. And there were certain things that it had. But that platform of truth, we were told, was a platform of truth that would take us from the time then present until Jesus came in the clouds of heaven. In other words, there might be some refining, there might be some tweaking, there might be some elevating that truth to a higher plane than hitherto has been given. But friends, it means that we don't need new radical messages brought into our movement because we've already been given the truth by God. Now I want you to turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 14. And we're going to read something that if you haven't read it lately, or maybe if you've never read it, might be almost shocking. Deuteronomy 14. Oh, I hope that many people are listening to what I'm saying. I'm hoping people are getting online even more as we go along now. We need this. Deuteronomy 14. And we're going to start reading in verse 23. And thou shalt eat before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose to place his name there, the tithe of the corn, of the wine, and thine oil, and the firstlings of thy herds and of thy flocks, that thou mayest learn to fear the Lord thy God always. Now, when he speaks about tithe, he's speaking about a second and an additional tithe here. Because the first tithe was very clear that the people weren't to use it themselves, it was to go to the priests. But he's talking about an additional tithe here. But now notice what he says that can be done with this. He says, now, there's going to be a place I'm going to show you. We know it later became Jerusalem. At first, the tabernacle was in Shiloh, then worship was established in Jerusalem. But he says in verse 24, and if the way be too long for thee, so that thou art not able to carry it, or if the place be too far from thee, which the Lord thy God shall choose to set his name there, when the Lord thy God hath blessed thee, then shalt thou turn it into money, and bind up the money in thine hand, and thou shalt go unto the place which the Lord thy God shall choose, and thou shalt bestow thy money for whatsoever thy soul lusteth after. Now that word lust is from a Hebrew, avah, which means to desire after. It's better translated to desire after. It doesn't mean lust in necessarily a sinful way, just that which you desire. But notice what your soul might desire. Maybe it's oxen, for oxen. Or for sheep, or for wine. Well, it must have surely been unfermented wine. But notice the next expression. Or for strong drink. Or for whatsoever thy soul desireth, and thou shalt eat there before the Lord thy God, and thou shalt rejoice, thou and thine household. And the Levite that is within thy gates, thou shalt not forsake him, for he hath no part nor inheritance with thee. Continuing verse 28. And in the 3 years thou shalt bring forth all the tithes of thine increase the same year, and thou shalt lay it up within thy gates. And the Levite, because he hath no part nor inheritance with thee, and the stranger and the fatherless and the widow, which are within thy gate, shall come and shall eat and be satisfied, that the Lord thy God may bless thee in all the work of thine hand which thou doest. What do you think about that? I'm at liberty to... Well, I'll tell you what, I picked up a hitchhiker this week. He's an interesting guy. He had a little dog and a cat on his back and a backpack, and we got going up the road together. And he said, I'm going to stop and visit Morgantown for about a week. I really like Morgantown. He's from Pennsylvania, this hitchhiker. I said, what do you like about Morgantown? So I said, oh, it's a big party town. He says they drink more Anheuser-Busch there than any other place in the world per capita. And I said, well, I don't know how you got that figure, but that might be true. So does this text mean that we can go to Morgantown now and start partying? We can have our wine and we can even have strong drink. Because that's what it says they could do. And I am not misinterpreting the text, and I'm not twisting the text exactly what the text says. Even fermented, strong drink and wine, at this point, were permitted. The question is why? We must remember, friends, that in times past, God often winked at gross ignorance. These things that were responsible for practices which in his sovereign will he would never permit nor approve. But eventually the time comes when on each point, as it says in Acts chapter 17 verse 30, God calls for every man, all men everywhere to do something what? To repent. To repent. Then those who persist in these practices, in spite of counsel and warning, as Jesus said, they have no cloak for their sin anymore, John 15, 22. Now, prior to that time, during this time of ignorance, prior to their being enlightened, they had not had sin, God says. And God did not hold them wholly accountable, even though their deeds were far short of the ideal. But his long-suffering extends to all. Remember what Jesus said on the cross? He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. But Paul, who at one time was very ignorant, who persecuted the church, he says he did it ignorantly in unbelief. 1 Timothy chapter 1 and 13. But there comes a time, friends, when ignorance must cease and repentance must start. And the winking at ignorance, God cannot continue to do. As an example, turn with me now to Exodus chapter 21, verse 1. Now these are the judgments which thou shalt set before them. If thou buy an Hebrew servant, 6 years he shall serve thee. Wait a minute. Buy a servant? You buy a servant? Doesn't mean servant, does it? What does it mean? Slave. If you buy a slave, here's how you do it. You mean God allowed them to have slaves? Yes, he did. He did try to make provision for their welfare. For instance, in verse 20, if a man smite his servant or his slave or his maid with a rod and he die under his hand, he shall surely be punished. Well, you know, you can't beat your slave to death. And certain things, if you knocked his tooth out, you could go free and whatnot. But friends, even in the Christian church in the time of Jesus and in the time of Paul, slavery was not immediately abolished. But masters were instructed to deal kindly with their slaves. That's right. Ephesians chapter 6. Let's read it from the New Testament. Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 9. And ye masters, do the same things unto them, referring to their slaves, forbearing, threatenings, knowing that your master is also in heaven, neither is there respective persons with him. In Colossians chapter 4 and verse 1. Masters, give unto your servants that which is just and equal, knowing that ye also have a master in heaven. So actually, although it was not his sovereign will for slavery to exist in the time of Paul, it was an option in the time of Paul, wasn't it? I ask you the question, is it an option today? Do you think slavery is right today? Just because it was an option then, should it still be an option today? Was it God's sovereign will that there ever, ever be a slave? Friends, we're all slaves to sins. He never wanted anyone to be a slave to sin, or a slave to another man. Men ruling over men. This was never God's design, never God's will. But he allowed it because of the ignorance. And he says, the times of the ignorance is past. You know, God gave Moses laws designed to help create stable homes. However, they did not directly abolish the practice of polygamy. They did try to discourage it. You can read about that in Leviticus 18:18, Deuteronomy 17:17. But God allowed Abraham, and then later David, and of course Solomon, to have many, many wives. And the fact is that there even still seems to be the provision in the New Testament for polygamy. Turn with me to 1 Timothy chapter 3. That is, of course, unless you want to be a bishop or a deacon. 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1. This is a true saying, if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. Bishop synonymous with elder here. Notice, a bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife. You mean I can have more than one wife? Apparently so, if you're not a bishop. That's what it says. Verse 12. Let the deacons be the husbands of one wife, not two or three. Now I'll ask you a question. In the patriarchal time of Abraham, polygamy was allowed. Discouraged. Provisions were made. But it was allowed. In the time of David, under the kings, it was allowed. In the time of the New Testament, it was allowed. It was an option. Is it an option today for us as Christians? Why not? Because it was never God's sovereign will in the beginning. And God allowed them through their ignorance to maintain this practice for a while, but today he calls everyone to repent. In a similar way, God made provision for the practice of divorce. But Jesus said in Matthew chapter 19, verse 18, no, I'm sorry, Matthew chapter 19, verse 8, he says, from the beginning it was not so. But for a time, and not just simply for adultery only, God suffered it and gave instructions designed to safeguard the rights of women, to mitigate the sufferings that resulted from these practices, and to protect the marriage relationship from grosser abuses. You can read about it in Exodus chapter 21, verses 7 through 11. Whereas on the one hand, God did not forbid Abraham, for instance, to take a second wife, Hagar. On the other hand, he did not protect him from the evils that resulted from such a curse of that action. And of course, Solomon, look at the problems that Solomon got into because of this wives. And so I'd like to say, just so that there's no question left, and I know I have a good brother who lives over near you, Leon, that I'd like to just share this part for so we don't miss out on this. And so with wine and strong drink. In the beginning, neither was strictly prohibited, except to those engaged in the religious services of the tabernacle and apparently also to some civil magistrates. But the evils of wine and strong drink were clearly portrayed out in the scriptures. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1, wine is a mocker and strong drink is raging. He who is deceived thereby is what? Is not wise. Very clear pronouncements. Proverbs chapter 23, verses 29 through 33. And there was a curse pronounced upon those who would overindulge in the drinking of wine. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 15. And as we discussed earlier in another class, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, we are told that whether we eat or drink or whatsoever we do, we are to do all to the glory of God. And laying in a drunken gutter, friends, doesn't bring God any glory. I've been there, I know. God tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and any man who defiles the temple of the Holy Spirit, him shall God what? Destroy. That's very plain. Intoxicants defile the temple of God, and their use cannot be considered a means of glorifying God. Paul abandoned the use of everything harmful to his body. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, we should read this one. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 27. Paul says, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. Paul says, I've brought my body into strict temperance on all matters. Because after I've preached to others, I don't want to become a castaway. So remember that, young preacher. Take care of yourself. Take care of the temple that God has given you. There is no excuse today for the argument that there is nothing intrinsically wrong with the use of intoxicants on the basis that God once permitted them. As we already noted, God also once permitted such practices as slavery, polygamy, no-fault divorce, if you please. The Bible warns, friends, further that drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of God. So let us not be deceived on this issue. So there are things that we can look at that clearly we see a line of progression of truth, a line of understanding what is right and what is wrong, where God says, you were at one time in ignorance about many of these things, but I'm calling you now to repent. And because of the hardness of your hearts, I have allowed certain things to continue, but no more, but no more. Now, what about the feasts? Are they optional for the people? Are they optional for the people? Because at one time, they clearly were commanded. The people were commanded and required to. And I think we need to understand that the Jewish people, they looked forward to these feasts. They were times of great national celebration. They were times of festivity. They were times of happiness and joy. Turn with me to Acts chapter 18, verse 20. It says, when they desired him to tarry, referring to Paul, longer with them, he consented not, but bade them farewell, saying, I must by all means keep this feast that cometh in Jerusalem, but I will return again unto you, if God will. And he sailed from Ephesus. Paul, he said he had a desire to go and to attend that feast. Turn with me to Psalms 122. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. O Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together. Whether the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, unto the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord. For there are thrones of judgment and thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee. All those people, they love to go to Jerusalem. They love to attend those annual feasts. Paul kept the Passover. It was called the National Festival of the Jews. When he did this when with the converts at Philippi. In fact, Acts chapter 20 and verse 6. It says, "And we sailed away from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread and came unto them to Troas in 5 days, where we abode 7 days." So they had been there for the Passover and unleavened bread. They're synonymous. And he mentions Pentecost also. Paul was willing, he said, well, in fact, let's read this in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 19. Paul was willing to be all things to all people if he could win people, as long as he didn't compromise. He says, "For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant to all, that I might gain the more." I've made myself servant to all, so I might gain the more. Verse 20, "And unto the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might gain the Jews, to them that are under the law, as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law." Verse 21, "To them that are without law, as without law, being not without law to God, but under the law to Christ, that I might gain them that are without the law. To the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I am made all things to all men, that I might by all means save some." Now I'd like to propose to you that the years from 34 to 70, or AD 34 to AD 70, were years of a transition period from the Jewish law and the customs into the Christian observance and the Christian ordinances. And Paul indeed kept some of the Jewish laws that were not mandatory after the death of Christ. From Sketches from the Life of Paul, page 105, it says, "Paul did not bind himself nor his converts to the ceremonies and customs of the Jews with their varied forms, types, and sacrifices." Now, while Paul at times kept some of these observances, it says that he did not bind himself nor his converts to them. In other words, he didn't feel it was mandatory, but it seems to be very much clearly here that it was optional at that time. That's true. It was optional at that time, and that is true. The Passover, I mentioned, was considered the national festival of the Jews. But I actually have an inspired quote for that, and I want to share it with you now. And it's from the book Desire of Ages, page 652. Desire of Ages, 652. "Christ was standing at the point of transition between two economies and their two great festivals. He, the spotless Lamb of God, was about to present himself as a sin offering, that he would thus bring to an end the system of types and ceremonies that for 4,000 years had pointed to his death. As he ate the Passover with his disciples, he instituted in its place the service that was to be the memorial of his great sacrifice. The national festival of the Jews was to pass away forever. The service which Christ established was to be observed by his followers in all lands and through all ages." And what is, if I may ask you, that service that he established? We call it the Lord's Supper or communion. Two great festivals, the Passover. The Passover was like the Jews' 4th of July. It was like their big holiday of the year. And there was a time of transition that these people had to go through. And from about 34 AD until the temple was destroyed and everything was dispersed, there was a transition that was occurring because of the hardness of the hearts of the people. And you see it today, friends. Listen, you show someone the truth about the Sabbath. You show someone the truth about the state of the dead. And you try to get them to come out of the other churches sometimes. And it's hard. It's a struggle for them to pull away from that which they've been associated with all their lives. And you do the same thing in Adventism, friends. You show them how the testimony has been ignored. You show them how the church today is in apostasy. And still, it's just like pulling teeth to get the people to follow the message of Revelation chapter 18, verse 4. Right? Sometimes it takes a transition period. People have to learn a little bit and be able to grasp it and go with it. But friends, we're coming down near the end now. And if there was ever a time when ignorance cannot any longer be offered as an excuse, it should be today. And maybe you've never seen all these verses. Maybe you haven't seen the references I'm going to be giving you in a little bit, but it's time to do it. It's time to do it. So can Passover be gone? I'm going to ask you this. Can Passover be gone, and yet we keep the Feast of Unleavened Bread? Because it says here in this statement that this was to be done away with forever. The national festival of the Jews was to pass away forever. So does that mean, well, if the Passover is gone, I should still keep Unleavened Bread? Or I should still keep Tabernacles? And remember that Unleavened Bread was synonymous with Passover. In fact, Luke chapter 22 and verse 1. Now the Feast of Unleavened Bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover. They were synonymous. There was technically the day that they killed the Passover, and then you had the Feast of Unleavened Bread, but they all considered it as one. Can we keep Tabernacles and yet believe that Passover is gone? So I'm asking the question today. Are these things optional? Was it God's sovereign will for them to continue to be optional, because they were optional at one time during this transition period? Now I'd like to get to the really heart of what we want to look at as far as some very point-blank statements. This is from Sketches to the Life of Paul. And this is going to give us some very important insight. Please listen carefully. It begins by saying, Paul and Barnabas soon after returned to Antioch in Syria, where they again labored for some, and many Gentiles there embraced the doctrine of Christ. But certain Jews from Judea raised a general consternation among the believing Gentiles by agitating the question of circumcision. Now, what was the question about that they were agitating? About circumcision. They asserted with great assurance that none could be saved without being circumcised and keep the entire ceremonial law. Continuing. This was an important question, and one which affected the church in a very great degree. Paul and Barnabas met it with promptness and opposed introducing the subject to the Gentiles. They were opposed in this by the believing Jews of Antioch, which favored the position of those in Judea. The matter resulted in much discussion and want of harmony in the church until finally the church of Antioch, apprehending that a division among them would occur from any further discussion of the question, decided to send Paul and Barnabas together with some responsible men of Antioch to Jerusalem to lay the matter before the apostles and elders. Now you remember, if you read, for instance, the stories of the early church, Timothy, his father was a Greek, and he was not circumcised when he was born. But as Paul was traveling with him, if people found out that Paul was traveling with this uncircumcised guy, it would cause a prejudice and a dissension in that time. So what did Paul do? He had him circumcised as a man. But Titus, on the other hand, he wouldn't let him be circumcised because it was in a different place, in a different situation. That circumcision at the time was optional. There's no question about that. But let's continue. There they were to meet delegates. That was at Jerusalem. There where they were to meet delegates from the different churches and those who had come to attend the approaching annual festivals. Meanwhile, all controversy was to cease until a final decision should be made by the responsible men of the church. This decision was then to be universally accepted by the various churches throughout the country. Continuing. The apostles, in making their way to Jerusalem, called upon the brethren of the cities through which they passed and encouraged them by relating their experience in the work of God and the conversion of the Gentiles to the faith. Upon arriving at Jerusalem, the delegates from Antioch related before the assembly of the churches the success that had attended the ministry with them and the confusion that had resulted from the fact that certain converted Pharisees declared that the Gentile converts must be circumcised and keep the law of Moses in order to be saved. The Jews were not generally prepared to move as fast as the providence of God opened the way. And I just pause there. I'm going to tell you, sometimes Seventh-day Adventists aren't prepared to move any faster either. We're just about as set in our ways as were the Jews. She continues, it was evident to them from the result of the apostles' labors among the Gentiles that the converts among the latter people would far exceed the Jewish converts, and that if the restrictions and ceremonies of the Jewish law were not made obligatory upon their accepting the faith of Christ, the national peculiarities of the Jews, which kept them distinct from all other people, would finally disappear from among those who embraced the gospel truths. The Jews had prided themselves upon their divinely appointed services, and they concluded that as God once specified the Hebrew manner of worship, it was impossible that he should ever authorize a change in any of his specifications. Let me just stop there. It says that the Jews prided themselves in these divinely appointed services. They weren't something that they made up. It's very clear. They were divinely appointed. They were given of God. There's no question about that. And these people prided themselves upon it. And they thought, you know, if God gave these services, he could never change them. Continuing, they decided that Christianity must connect itself with the Jewish laws and ceremonies. They were slow to discern to the end of that which had been abolished by the death of Christ. Now, there's a couple key words there, if I could pause for a minute. Abolished and? Where do you have to go to get to the end? What does abolished mean? I mean, I'm not trying to play with words. I don't think Ellen White's trying to play with words either here today. These are straightforward, understandable concepts. So this is an end. Something was abolished. We're at the end of it. She says, and to perceive that all their sacrificial offerings had but prefigured the death of the Son of God, in which type had met its antitype, rendering valueless the divinely appointed ceremonies and sacrifices of the Jewish religion. Well, friends, we're told we don't keep the sacrifices. We just keep the days. We keep the ideas. But she says not only the sacrifices, but the ceremonies became valueless. Now, I didn't say that. That's what this prophetess of God said. And you can believe it or you don't have to believe her. It's up to you. But I want to tell you it's the gospel truth. Continuing, and please notice this very important statement. Paul had prided himself upon his Pharisaical strictness. But after the revelation of Christ to him on the road to Damascus, the mission of the Savior and his own work in the conversion of the Gentiles were plain to his mind, and he fully comprehended the difference between a living faith and a dead formalism. Do you see two things contrasted here? A living faith and a dead formalism. Paul still claimed to be one of the children of Abraham and kept the Ten Commandments in letter and in spirit as faithfully as he'd ever done before his conversion to Christianity. But, when you see that little word but, it means something's changing now, right? Amen. But, he knew that the typical ceremonies must soon all together cease, since that which they had shadowed forth had come to pass, and the light of the gospel was shedding its glory upon the Jewish religion, giving a new significance to its ancient rites. Do you see that part that's highlighted there? He knew that the typical ceremonies must soon altogether cease. There was a point in Paul's experience when they had not yet altogether ceased. Do you see that? They hadn't yet altogether ceased. In other words, there was an option. It was an option, that's true. But what was going to happen? They were going to soon partially cease. Ceases as an option for some, but not others. It says that they were to soon altogether cease. Now I have a question for you. How soon is soon? How soon is soon? We're talking here about almost 2,000 years ago. Almost 2,000 years ago, they were to soon almost cease. So I ask you the question, have we finally come to that time? Have we taken 2,000 years as Christianity to come to this place where they haven't altogether ceased yet? Have we been in Adventism now for 160 some years and we have not seen the light on this, and God has been displeased with us so much that he hasn't shown us the truth on this matter? I don't think so. I don't think so at all. Concerning the Lord's Supper, the ordinance of foot washing, and this experience, we are told this in the Review and Herald of June 14, 1898. This ordinance does not speak so largely to man's intellectual capacity as to his heart. His moral and spiritual nature needed. If his disciples had not needed this, it would have not been left for them as Christ's last established ordinance in connection with and including the Last Supper. And now notice the next statement. It was Christ's desire to leave to his disciples an ordinance that would do for them the very thing they needed. You need something. You may want something, but you may need something. What's the difference? What's the difference between wanting something and needing something? If I need something, it's mandatory. If I want something, it's an option. Isn't that right?
Yes.
So if it's something that I need, it's not optional, friends. It was Christ's desire to leave to his disciples an ordinance that would do for them the very thing they needed. What do they need? That would serve to disentangle them from the rites and ceremonies which they had hitherto engaged in as essential, and which the reception of the gospel made no longer of any force. To continue these rites would be an insult to Jehovah.
Amen.
I think I read that right. To continue these rites would be an insult to Jehovah. Now, friends, many times we have done things in ignorance. We've done things because of the hardness of our hearts, and we just couldn't clearly see through. But I want to tell you, if you love the God of this universe, the sovereign of the universe, do you want to insult him? Do you want to say, look, the sacrifice of Jesus just isn't enough. I've got to add to it now. Yes, these divinely appointed ceremonies, they taught the people, they helped them to understand that the reality was coming, that the one that this lamb prefigured would actually come and die as a sacrifice for the human race, so that my sin, your sin, could be forgiven, so that that besetting sin of anger or mistrust or whatever it might be can be overcome fully and completely through the blood of Jesus Christ. We can be so thankful for that today. But I think that we, like those disciples, we have a need, and that would be to disentangle us from the rites and the ceremonies and the shadows, because, friends, there's no power in them. Do you understand that? There's no power in them. You know, you can say, well, God, we had this meeting and God blessed it in a certain way. Well, I'll address that in a minute. But let's continue. One more paragraph from this statement. Eating of the body and drinking of the blood of Christ, not merely at the sacramental service, but daily partaking of the bread of life to satisfy the soul's hunger, would be in receiving his word and doing his will. And that's where we should be today, friends. Friends, we need a living faith today, a living faith based upon breaking the bread of life and daily partaking of it, and not a dead formalism. Well, what about this option idea again? I just want to speak very directly to this matter. If the feasts are right, and if they are true, then how dare we tell people that they do not have to obey them? If they're right, and if they're true, we should be damned for telling people to avoid them. If, on the other hand, the feasts are an insult to Jehovah, how dare we teach and preach that the people should do them, or they should at least have the option to do them, and be complicit in the insult of our God? Now, just as a historical basis, so you know, the Adventist pioneers did not teach that we should keep the feasts. J.N. Andrews, for instance, in making a remark about a paper that Crozier had written, said the ordinances of the Jewish church were abolished. The ordinances of the Christian church have taken their place. William Miller, as quoted by James White, stated, and it's a little lengthy, but I'll read it. I say, I believe I am supported by the Bible, that the moral law was never given to the Jews as a people exclusively, but they were for a season the keepers of it. And through them, the law, oracles, and testimony have been handed down to us. See Paul's clear reasoning in Romans 2, 3, 4 on that point. Then says the objector, we are under the same obligation to keep the Sabbaths of weeks, months, and years that the Jews were. No, sir. You will only observe that these were not included in the Decalogue. Continuing, only one kind of Sabbath was given to Adam, and only one remains for us. See Hosea 2:11. I will cause all her mirth to cease, her feast days, her new moons, and her Sabbaths, and all her solemn feasts. All the Jewish Sabbaths did cease when Christ nailed them to his cross. Colossians 2:14-17. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Continuing, Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or the new moon or the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. These were properly called Jewish Sabbaths. Hosea says, her Sabbaths, but the Sabbath of which we are speaking, God calls my Sabbath. Here is clear distinction between the creation Sabbath and the ceremonial. One is perpetual, the others were merely shadows of good things to come and are limited in Christ. And this is from William Miller's Life and Views, pages 161, 162, quoted by James White in Life Instances. This is page 284 and 286. Well, James White had something to say about this as well. You might want to know that. In the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald of February 18, 1862, he said, "The feasts, the new moons, and Sabbaths of the ceremonial law, which Paul declared to be abolished in consequence of the abrogation of that code, have been particularly noticed already. That the Sabbath of the Lord is not included in their number, the following facts evidence." And then he goes on to list the evidence that he has for that point. Writing a few years earlier in 1849 in The Present Truth, he said, "The first covenant, which had ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary, was a shadow of the second and better covenant. The law was the shadow, and the gospel is the body that cast the shadow. And as all shadows reach to their body no further, it is very clear that the sacrifices and oblations, new moons, feast days, and Sabbaths of the Jewish law ceased when the precious body and blood of the Lamb of God was sacrificed on the cross." This is what Paul calls nailing it to his cross. Uriah Smith, in the Bible Institute, page 139, said, "The feast days, new moons, and ceremonial Sabbaths, which as shadows were to cease at the cross, God declared that he would take away," making reference to Hosea 2:11. And you might find this interesting, a reference to the Waldensians. This is quoted from Christian Edwards' Facts of Faith, "that we are to worship only one God who is able to help us and not the saints depart, that we ought to keep holy the Sabbath day, but that there was no necessity of observing other feasts." Now, it might be objected that Ellen White made a statement such as this one. In Review and Herald of November 17, 1885, Ellen White said, "It would be well for us to have a Feast of Tabernacles." Have you ever read that statement before? What does she mean by this? Well, I think it's best to let her describe what she means here. And I think as we look at the context of this and other similar statements, we can find out exactly what she means. We don't have to be in question about. This is from the Bible Echo of December 8, 1893. This is an Australian publication. Remember, Ellen White was in Australia at that time. She says, "Shall we not gather our forces together and come up to the Feast of Tabernacles?" That sounds encouraging if you believe in keeping feasts, doesn't it? "Let us not treat this matter as one of little importance, but let the army of the Lord be on the ground to represent the working cause of God in Australia. Let no one plead an excuse at such a time. One of the reasons why we have appointed the camp meeting to be held at Melbourne is that we desire the people of that vicinity to become acquainted with our doctrines and work. We want them to know what we are and what we believe. Let everyone pray and make God his trust. Those who are barricaded with prejudice must hear the warning message for this time. Therefore, come to the camp meeting, even though you have to make a sacrifice to do so." And do you notice the date? They were having a camp meeting in December. She's writing in the Echo, "You come to this Feast of Tabernacles." Now I want to ask you, when was the literal Feast of Tabernacles held? It was held in the autumn, not in the winter. She's using this as a figurative expression for the camp meeting, a time of rejoicing, a time when they could come together and study God's Word and learn. Another time she said this, "Then shall your life henceforth be a continual Feast of Tabernacles, a continual thank offering." She was speaking about giving thanks and a thank offering. Now, James White also wrote something that we should notice about this Feast of Tabernacles. And he was writing about a camp meeting that was being held in Melbourne, Kansas. And that camp meeting opened in May 25, 1876. Did you get the date? The camp meeting began May 25, 1876. He said, "This excellent meeting, with all its labors of preparation, anxiety, preaching, hearing, exhorting, confession of sin, and want of Christ, its tears, deliverance, and joys, is now past. Those parents who brought their children to the meeting and saw them converted and take the baptismal vow are now glad that they brought them. Those who did not bring their children regretted their mistake. These annual Feasts of Tabernacles are gatherings of the greatest importance, and there should be a general turnout of all who may be benefited. Now, that was written in the Signs of the Times, June 8, 1876, but he's making reference to the camp meeting that occurred just prior to that, in May the 25th. And he says that these are what he calls annual Feasts of Tabernacles. Now, this was again at the Malvern, Kansas camp meeting, May 25. Is that anywhere near the time the Feast of Tabernacles normally was held? I mean, it is almost as far away from it as it could possibly be. But he calls it that. But you know, I've seen people quote James White just like this. They quote him out of context. These annual Feasts of Tabernacles are gatherings of the greatest importance. And I was reading on a blog this morning where someone had put this in. They said, I agree with Elder White right here, full-heartedly, you know, we should be keeping the Feast of Tabernacles. And that wasn't at all what he was talking about. The text out of context is truly a pretext. Clearly, for James and Ellen White, the Feast of Tabernacles, this phraseology, found its meaning in the present-day camp meetings held at various times throughout the years. So what excuses do we have today? Well, I talked this last Wednesday night about miracles. You remember miracles? We talked about miracles. Are miracles a test of anything?
No,
they're not, friends, because even Satan and his cohorts will perform legitimate miracles. The Bible says that. By the power to do the miracles they had. I can go to a meeting and I can find all kinds of things that seem miraculous going on, but it doesn't prove it's true. You know that? I can go tomorrow to a little church about a mile from here, and who knows what I may see and hear there. And they're going to testify, because it's a Pentecostal church, they're going to testify these things are there because the Spirit of God is working there. And that Spirit of God is also telling them that they don't have to keep the Sabbath. The Spirit of God is also telling them that they can eat pork or do anything else they want like that they want. That Spirit of God is telling them that their loved ones are already in heaven. But no, miracles are happening, so it must be true. Or maybe I can test things because everybody is so nice and loving to me. After all, Jesus said, by this shall all men know you are my disciples, if you have love one to another. We do need to have more love to one another. We do need to have a genuine care and concern, friends. But I can go to many places, and I can find this so-called love, this so-called acceptance, open arms for this brother of strange faith. I can find it in all these Protestant churches, Protestant churches. It's not a test, friends. The test is the Word of God alone. The Word of God alone. And the Bible says that there were times of ignorance that God winked at. But friends, we're not at those times of ignorance today. We're in a better time, in a better position than any group of people ever have. In one of the Sabbath school classes here, we were talking about the fact that we're living in the end time. There's 144,000 that have a special mission, a special work, and they're special people. And the requirement for them to be 144,000 is not the same thing as required for someone to die 100 years ago. Isn't that right?
Amen.
And if there was ever a time that we should not be pleading ignorance, if there was ever a time, in fact, to the contrary, that we should be saying exactly what is right and know what we believe. Remember what Jesus said? He said, we speak that which we do know. Do we? Or do we just go off with ideas and hopefully one of them is right? You know, it's just like blindfolding yourself and trying to pin the tail on the donkey. You know, you're out there somewhere trying to find the wall, hoping you'll hit. If you keep doing it enough, eventually you'll hit. But how many times we're going to get stuck in between till we find it? Beloved, in recapping quickly, because I know we've went long here today. There was a time in the early church as there was a transitional period going on. Because of the ignorance and because of the hardness of the hearts, because of the deep-seatedness of the experience of the Jewish people, that certain issues like circumcision, certain issues like the feast days, were allowed as an optional thing for the people. There's no question that that happened. But there's also no question, friends, that we are living in a more enlightened time. Just like we don't drink alcoholic beverages today. We don't practice polygamy today. We don't have slaves today. Why? Even though those things were allowed in the Bible, they were allowed in the Old Testament and New Testament both. That's exactly right. But do we do those today? No, because we believe that we have a greater, better understanding today, friends. I don't want to insult Jehovah, do you?
No.
And beloved, if you found error with my message today, then you come and talk to me. And you show me, Brother Allen, here's a better way. I want to follow the better way, don't you?
Yes.
But friends, I think that we have incontrovertible statements here. We have the Word of God, and we can depend upon it, and it is true, and it is faithful. And may God add His blessing to the reading of His Word this day. And may God bless each one of you, lots and lots.